evening. Welcome to church tonight. Let's all stand together. Grab your hymnal. Turn to page 517. We'll sing, I Am Resolved, page 517. So sweet to trust in Jesus. Page 534.
Jesus, for grace to trust. Good evening. It's good to see you tonight. Thank you for being in church on this wonderful Michigan evening. Every time I looked out the window today, it was doing something different. I didn't know what was coming next. So thank you for being here tonight. Let's bow together, and we'll ask for the Lord's help in the service tonight. Lord, thank you for bringing us safely to this place again. Lord, thank you for the blessings of the week. Lord, thank you for the hard work that's gone into this place this week. So many people come by and doing some things. God, I pray you'd bless the time we have together. As our children are meeting downstairs, God, would you bless their time and please speak to their hearts. And then, Lord, would you please make your word very real and alive to us tonight. Well, thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. If you did not get a missionary prayer letter on the way in, hold your hand up good and high and we'll get you one real quick. We'll bring it to you. Brother Stephen is back there. If you didn't get one, hold your hand up. Don't be shy. Hold it up good and high. Miss Jenkins, Miss Kennedy, is that a yes, you do need one? Or okay, a couple over here too, Brother Steve. We're going to start tonight with reading the prayer letter from Brother Brenton. They are in the Philippines. A couple of people have asked me about the whites and how they're doing. There was an earthquake in Taiwan, and then they had tsunami warnings as a result in the Philippines. And I got a message from Brother Brenton this morning early about something unrelated, and he didn't mention anything about the tsunami. Yeah, I'm assuming everything is good there. Let's start reading together on their letter. They are in the Philippines on the island of Mindanao. That is the largest island of the Philippines, also the southernmost, I believe. He says, continuing on in our everyday Bible study at Rusco, which is the truck dealership, the manager, who is a Christian, is delighted to have that ministry. We have been steadily making progress, exploring all kinds of different biblical subjects and topics, and I have seen the Lord working conviction on hearts and stirring interest in hearing more of the Word of God. Now I am having them pick up some of the subjects and or Bible questions for us to study. It is truly a blessing to see the Lord work on their hearts. It is also improving my Cebuano greatly. That's the language they speak there. Please pray that the Lord will protect that ministry and that it will continue. Some Koreans came to visit Happy Land School for a month as a missions trip out of the school owner's church in Korea. It was quite interesting to see how different their mannerisms and things are, and I was able to practice a little bit of Korean myself and have some decent fellowship. If you'll recall that he got the opportunity to teach, I believe it's 3 or 4 times a week at this school that's mentioned here, Happy Land School. It's a school that started as a private school started by a man from Korea. And so this is what he's talking about. Some people from his church in Korea came on a mission trip to do some work at the school. He says, I was asked to teach an English class and got 3 Korean students in my class 1 to 3 times a week. They taught me some Korean and I taught them some English. One of the students, Emma, is looking to move to the States and go to a Christian college, and she wants her English pronunciation to be perfect. So we helped her with that as well. It was a fruitful time to help many of my Korean Christian brethren and a unique experience for sure. One of the Filipino kids had a birthday party in one of our 6th grade classes, and I got to spend a bit of time with them after our Bible classes, and all of them are retaining a good, solid interest in the Scriptures. Praise the Lord. They had their exams this month, and I have yet to find out how they did, but they typically do great. I have seen a lot of conviction, and you can definitely tell which ones are serious for the Lord, which ones are wavering, and which ones just love the world but will tolerate gospel preaching. So it is with all adults as well. That's a good description of things in America as well, I'm convinced. It says, the car broke down again. We had an oil leak and a radiator leak. They fixed the oil leak, but when they gave it back to me, they forgot to put oil in it. That's a problem. So I got the knocking sound on the engine, and it died on the highway. Plus, they didn't fix the radiator leak. So they came and towed it back to the shop, and I'm back to commuting. A lot of walking and getting on smaller Filipino-style vehicles, which gives a good opportunity for me to witness. I got to witness to several Bobo drivers, taxi drivers, and also pass out tracts. Had several people ecstatic to hear a white person speak their language. We were blessed to go to a church meeting where Pastor Gene Kim was preaching. He came with his wife to visit the Philippines and preach in Cebu and Mindanao. It was a blessing to be in a special meeting like that and to talk with another brother in Christ. Also, we were able to fellowship with some of our Filipino pastor brethren, which was a blessing. That's all for our report. Hold the fort, for Jesus is coming. And then we have the Xavier family. They are our missionaries in Uruguay, and some of our young people recently went on a trip there. In fact, I believe that's mentioned here in this letter. It says, ministry is all about people, and the last several months have been full of people, even more than usual. We have had a very busy and blessed summer so far here in Colonia. Thank you for your faithful prayers on our behalf. Here are some pictures to show you just what's been going on and what the Lord has done in our midst. From January 1st to 8th, our church had the privilege of hosting a team of 14 workers from Faith Baptist Church in Davison, Michigan. They were all a huge blessing to us and our church in many ways, getting 14 ISO panels in place for the roof over our new fellowship hall, painting at the church, and deep cleaning a house for a new family. We also enjoyed their music ministry and more. Thank you, Faith BC. We as a family also had the privilege of hosting three girls from Faith Baptist Church in Chelsea, Michigan for 3 weeks, Hannah, Mariah, and Becca. All three of them were a great blessing to us in many ways. They taught children's classes, played instruments, helped with VBS, attended teen camp, and just accompanied us in many aspects of ministry here. Thank you, girls, for your ministering among us. January means Anniversary Sunday and baptisms here in Colonia. 11 people followed the Lord in believers' baptism on our church's 26th anniversary on January 21st. One of them was our Hannah. That's one of the missionary's daughters. Thank you for praying for new converts and their discipleship. We had 2 days of day camp for 75 children ages 6 to 12. A team of Sunday school teachers, seminary students, and other adults worked together. The Lord touched lives and 13 salvation decisions were made. The new fellowship hall was a special blessing as our dining area. Teen camp, the last week in January, was also a special blessing for young people from all over Uruguay. We had the privilege of hearing the word from Pastor Josiah and Sheila Kagan from Grace Baptist Church in Kettering, Ohio. God did a mighty work, and we saw many consecration decisions made. And then he's got a verse there from 1 Corinthians at the very bottom there. I love the fact that he mentioned many consecration decisions being made. So many times we think that things are a failure if there's not a list of people who made salvation decisions. But I'm telling you, in the world that we're living in America, and Uruguay has a society and a culture, the culture may be a little bit different, but society and the religious temperature of the country is much the same as the United States. And to hear decisions of people consecrating their lives to the Lord, that's precious to me, especially when we're talking about youth at a camp. I think that's just as important as salvation decisions. Let's spend some time this evening praying for these missionaries. I'll lead us in prayer, and you join me together as we pray. One thing that is not mentioned in Brother White's letter is that Miss Christina is having some pretty serious medical problems, and he would appreciate the prayers of God's people on her behalf. So though it's not mentioned in the letter we just read, if you would, maybe just make a note there and maybe send yourself a message, whatever you got to do to remind yourself to pray for Miss Christina White and the children. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for another chance to come together and focus on missions for just a few minutes. Lord, I am grateful for the missionaries that we are able to support here at this church. God, thank you for the sacrifices that they have made. Lord, thank you for the families that are serving you in these places, not just an individual, but entire families. Lord, I do pray for the Whites. God, you know the busyness of their schedule. You know how hectic things get for them. And then, Lord, with these problems he's having with his car, and Lord, his health problems with his wife, and she's trying to school the children and all that needs to go into that. Father, you're aware of all these details, and God, I pray that you would please, first of all, I pray that you would meet those needs and that you would be glorified through them. But then also, Father, I pray that you would burden our hearts and remind us of the needs that this family has on the other side of the world. Lord, in that Pacific area, Lord, things are very difficult, and to be a family living in a different culture, Lord, it just adds to the complexity of everything, from trying to get a car fixed to trying to do the grocery shopping on foot and all of those things. Lord, I pray that you'd please encourage this family. God, would you somehow, Lord, give them a very special blessing. And then, Lord, I pray that you would continue to provide for them and protect them. And then, Lord, we thank you for the Xavier family. Thank you for their testimony and their witness there in Uruguay. Lord, I pray that you'd please continue to bless their ministry. God, give them creative ways to find opportunity to tell someone about you. Lord, thank you for all of the work that went into the teen camp and, Lord, the kids camp and all their outreach. Father, thank you for that. Now, Lord, I pray that you would be pleased and that you would be glorified in their ministry. Lord, thank you for the baptisms they've mentioned. Lord, we know baptism doesn't save, but as a public testimony, Lord, we're grateful for the salvation that was professed through those baptisms. Lord, I pray that you would encourage Brother Xavier and his wife and those children. Lord, would you please continue to bless and protect them in the field that they're serving on. And then, Lord, I pray the same thing for all of our missionaries. God, you have allowed us to partner with 38 solid missionaries. And God, I pray that you would bless them and take care of them, Lord. Provide for them and sustain them and their families. And we'll thank you for all of these things, Lord. We love you. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. As I was reading the Xavier's letter a minute ago, Mariah had me laughing. I don't know if it was this morning or last night. She got a video message from their family, and it would have been on Sunday, I guess it was, when she got it. But they were trying to observe April Fool's Day, which is a mostly American holiday, and so they were trying to, and all of them are not from the United States, some of them are from Uruguay, and they sent her a very excited message saying that they were coming to the States to visit, and they were talking about, they were just the excitement in their voice, and at the end of the message, they all said, April Fools, and it wasn't that great of an April Fool's joke, but they thought it was like over the top, the best that had ever been made. That was what had me laughing, is their giddy laughter in the background. All right, let's stand together. I'll go play something on the piano, and then y'all can greet one another. We'll get ready for our Wednesday night offering, and you tell someone you're happy to see them this evening.
Let's sing that first verse of Power in the Blood. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power.
You can be seated this evening. Come on, ushers, we'll get her off. Let me make a couple announcements as they're coming. Don't forget about the seniors' luncheon tomorrow at 11:30. That'll be downstairs in the fellowship hall. All the senior citizens are invited to come and be a part of that. And so if you have questions about it, you can actually talk to Brother Dan or Miss Kelly Gill. And they can give you more details than I can at this point, but it'll start at 11:30 tomorrow. And then I was supposed to announce one more thing. Oh, we need help setting up tables downstairs as soon as the service is over. Brother Wireman will remind you again at the end of the service when he's done leading us in prayer. But if you're able to go downstairs, we got a pretty good group of young people here this evening, and so it won't take long. All the chairs are already cleared, guys, so take a deep breath. All you got to do is set up tables and then move the chairs back. So there's that. All right. Brother Piper, would you lift your voice good and loud, please, sir, and ask the blessing on the offering? Let's grab our Bibles and stand together and find Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4. I fully intended to announce it from the pulpit on Sunday night, and I just forgot, but Miss Nadine Leonard's father passed away. I believe it was Sunday afternoon. And so I think that's probably where Brother Tim and Miss Nadine are this evening, already in Pennsylvania. When is that service, Dwight, Kimberly? It's Friday. So you'd be in prayer for the family, if you would, please. That's, everything is in Pennsylvania. There won't be a service here, but you can be in prayer for them if you would. Galatians chapter 4. Let's begin reading together in verse 22, it says, "For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid and the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. Father, would you help us this evening? Lord, would you help us put all this together and help it make sense? God, when we leave this place, will you help us have a deeper appreciation for the grace that saved us and then the liberty that now we have in that grace? Well, thank you in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. You may be seated. We just read far more than we normally read together as we jump into our study, and if God will help us this evening, I've tried to come through the first part of the service as quickly as possible. It's rare that I get up and preach before about 35 after, but I've given myself 10 extra minutes, and so God being our helper tonight, I'd like to get all the way down, if not all the way through the end of chapter 4, very close to the end of chapter 4. And the reason I'd like to do that is because this passage, though when we read it like we just did, it does not seem like it, but the context flows without stop all the way to the end, and it's best understood if we leave it that way. And so that's my intent, that's my desire this evening. So before we get into those verses we just read, I need to read the end of and finish speaking about one verse before. It says there in verse 20, I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice. And we finished the last time we were together in the book of Galatians, we finished with what Paul was meaning by change my voice. He made it very clear through his letters to the Corinthians that he had a different voice when he was writing his letters. He felt as though it was better to be stern and hard and correcting in his letters and to, as he says in Corinthians, make them sorry through a letter so that when he's there in person, he can change his voice and not be that chastising father, but just be there as an encouraging friend and one that's there to enjoy the fellowship. And so we understood that, but the last phrase of that verse, I think, is very important. It says, I stand in doubt of you. I stand in doubt of you. And I think this is important because if this book of Galatians, this letter to the church of Galatia, had been penned in the year 2024, and a preacher addressed most modern-day churches with the way the Apostle Paul has addressed the church in Galatia, if he were to look them in the eye and say, your behavior has caused me to doubt you, most Christians would say, he has no right to talk to me that way. But all he's saying, though, is, I hear about what you're doing and have done. I hear about what you now believe and profess, and your decision to act that way and to embrace that belief causes me to react to you in a certain way. We say it this way, your choices have brought this reaction upon yourself. And it's that principle that is so offensive to people today. We don't like to be called out on things we do wrong. Man, I stirred up a firestorm mentioning Facebook on Sunday. I mentioned a firestorm, or I stirred it up anyway. Without going into it all again, Brother Wireman chastised me after church. Tried my best. Without getting into it all again, one of my biggest problems with the social media era is that it has created what people are perceiving as, or not, I don't even think they perceive it as, I think it has created something that people would like to believe is a completely isolated and separated imaginary world where you can be whoever you want to be, you can say whatever you want to say, you can post whatever picture you want to post, and no one in reality has the right to say anything bad about it. I have a problem with that. I said I wasn't going to get into it all again, and I won't. But the Apostle Paul here says, your actions and what everyone has seen and heard from you is causing true Christians to stand in doubt of you, to question who you are, your behavior, your beliefs, the things you're saying. It's not the behavior and the speech of real Christians. But I want you to notice he says, stand in doubt of you. Now, listen, if you were to go back, I'm not a Greek or Hebrew scholar. I don't know the first thing about it. I'm not going to stand here and pretend like I do. Most people who think they are read from the same lexicons and dictionaries that everybody else reads from. That's just a fact. Here's what I found, though. If you put all of this together, he's already talked to them about how they're his little children, how he's travailing in birth, travailing for them. He's laboring for them again. And then he gets to this point and he says, but I'm just standing in doubt of you. The original word that we get our word doubt from, it's used four times in the New Testament. Three of those times it's translated into English with the word doubt, and the fourth time it's perplexed. But all of them in their context simply mean to halt, to cease to be able to move forward. One of the definitions used, it's an old word. I've used it once and got laughed at, but I love the word. One of the old dictionaries, one of the old definitions used the word nonplussed. Nonplussed. It simply means to be not allowed to go further. The Apostle Paul says, I'm in the middle of laboring and travailing for you. But when I see how you're behaving and you're acting, I feel like I'm stuck and I cannot keep going forward. Now, I told you I'm not going to spend a bunch of time on this when I get to the end, but you need to know that it's still true that your actions affect others. Your actions affect others. And if a man of God like the Apostle Paul told a group of baby Christians that your behavior is setting me back, if someone as spiritually mature as the Apostle Paul could be stunted or halted by the actions of others, what do you think our actions are doing to other baby Christians? It's a sobering thought. Jesus told his disciples, you know a tree by the fruit it bears. A good tree bears good fruit. Bad trees bear bad fruit. We find the Apostle Paul telling people that they have refreshed him, not the Galatians. The Galatians have caused him to doubt. If you recall back in verse 11 of chapter 4, he tells them, I'm afraid of you. He tells some people, you've encouraged me. You've helped me. You've assisted me. Once and again, you've come and looked after my care, not the Galatians. He tells the Galatians, I'm afraid of you. And you've caused me to be perplexed, to be in doubt. I wonder, not in the world of social media, but in the world of reality, in the real world, I wonder what all of our actions and words do to others. Are we those who, if I'm not just talking about the preacher, I'm talking about just everyone in the entire body of Christ, everyone that we come in contact with, do we rub off on them in a good way or do we set them back? And after we part ways, they sit back and say, wow, I didn't see that coming. I mean, this is what Paul is saying. He said, you had good doctrine. We'll see in chapter 5. He says, you started out well. You did good. But something has changed, and now I'm afraid of you and I stand in doubt of you. I don't want that to be my reputation and my testimony. The Bible word is my report. I want people to look at Adam Summers and say, man, he sure is a help to me. Boy, when I am feeble-minded, he really strengthens me. When I just feel like I can't go on, that man really, he perceives it and he helps me. I don't want to be the guy that people avoid because they see how I talk and it doesn't line up with what I profess. You can connect the dots to Facebook however you want. Let's move on. Let's talk this evening with the balance of our time. Let's start reading in verse 22. I'm fully aware that I've skipped verse 21. I'd like to come back to verse 21 at the very end. Verse 22 says, "For it is written that Abraham had two sons. For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise." And then I want to draw your full attention to the first phrase of verse 24. Look at what it says. Which things are an allegory? Which things are an allegory? He's a preacher. What is the big deal? We all know what an allegory is. I know we know what an allegory is, but let's make sure we read the next few verses remembering what an allegory is. Because a big mistake has been made by a lot of well-meaning pastors and teachers who will take the information given in the next few verses, and most of you already know we're talking about Ishmael and Isaac. Those are the two sons. They take what little bit of information is given to them about them in this passage, and they combine it by going all the way back to the book of Genesis and looking at every detail of those men's births and lives and drawing comparisons and parallels that God never intended to be drawn. It does not say that every detail of their lives are identical to what they're being compared to. It simply says certain aspects, certain details serve as an allegory. Let me give you the definition of allegory. It says this: it's a figurative sentence or discourse in which the principal subject is described by another subject resembling it in its properties and circumstances. Now, it does not matter what dictionary, new or old, you go to. The word allegory, the definition has changed very little over the centuries. It simply means a slight resemblance of something else. Okay? Now, why is this important? This is important because there are some things the Bible says in the Old Testament are direct types and pictures of things in the New Testament. This is not one of them. This is simply an allegory. Now, let's get into it with that in mind. We are going to go read a little bit in Genesis, so go ahead and find Genesis, if you would please, the first book of your Bible. Find Genesis chapter 16, Genesis chapter 21. So that verse 22 says, Abram had two sons. Now let's look at these very briefly. We could read, but there's a lot of verses here in these two chapters, but time will not allow us to read the whole entire chapter. So let's just grab a couple of verses so that we understand what we're talking about. In Genesis chapter 16, verses 9 through 21 talk about the birth of Ishmael. Verse 1 says, "And Sarai, Abram's wife, bare him no children, and she had a handmaid, an Egyptian, whose name was Hagar." In our passage in Galatians, she's called Agar. In the Old Testament, though, the pronunciation is Hagar. "And Sarai said unto Abram, Behold now, the Lord hath restrained me from bearing. I pray thee, go in unto my maid, and it may be that I may obtain children by her. And Abram hearkened to the voice of Sarai. We could spend a lot of time talking about how big a mistake this was and how this was never God's will and blah, blah, blah. It's all there in Galatians, but it's not there. I'm sorry, it's all there in Genesis, but it's not there in Galatians. Oh, those are great lessons to learn about the will of God from Genesis, but that's not the principle taught in Galatians. The principle taught in Galatians is very small compared to the lessons we could learn from the entirety of the account of Hagar and Sarai. All right, so let's skip down a little bit to verse 15. It says, and Hagar bare Abram a son, and Abram called his son's name, which Hagar bare, Ishmael. And Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bare Ishmael to Abram. All right, so chapter 4, verse 22 of Galatians says that Abraham had two sons. We go back into Genesis chapter 16, and we find that the first son born to Abraham, his name was Abram at the time, the first son's name was Ishmael. Let's skip forward now to chapter 21 of Genesis. And there are some who would say, but preacher, all these chapters from chapter 16 all the way through chapter 21 and forward talk about Ishmael and Isaac. Yes, they do. But the book of Galatians doesn't. It doesn't need every detail of the life of these two men to make this short allegory. All we need is what the Bible gives us. So the Bible starts with saying Abraham had two sons. So let's grab that. We saw chapter 16. We saw the birth of Ishmael. Look at chapter 21. Chapter 21, let's start in verse 1. And the Lord visited Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did unto Sarah as he had spoken. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age at the set time of which God had spoken to him. And Abraham called the name of his son that was born unto him, whom Sarah bare to him, Isaac. All right, so chapter 4, verse 22 says Abraham had two sons. We've just seen, here's the two sons. Hagar bare unto him Ishmael, Sarai bare unto him Isaac. All right, let's go back to Galatians. Hold your place in Genesis. Jump back to Galatians chapter 4. Let's see what else the Bible tells us about these two men. And then let's get into how they are an allegory of what Paul is discussing in Galatians. We find one is called the bondwoman and one is called the free woman, right? You could save me some time by just acknowledging that we just read in Genesis that Sarai says to Abram, go in unto my maid. She is the bondwoman. She is bound in service to us. That's Hagar. The free woman mentioned in Galatians is not Hagar. Now, that would be the bondwoman. The free woman is Sarah. Sarah was the wife of Abraham. Sarah was not a maid to anybody. She had a maid. She was a free woman. She freely told Abraham to go in unto Hagar. She freely, as we'll see in a few minutes, told Abraham, I want this woman and her child gone. She was a free woman. Okay, this is important because Galatians says it's necessary to the allegory. All right, let's get into this allegory and let's see three or four things about this allegory that Paul is going to use to illustrate the difference and the importance of knowing the difference between law and grace. That is really what the struggle has been in Galatians up to this point. The Galatians were lied to and deceived into believing that they had to keep the Old Testament law. They were convinced that they were still under the old covenant after Paul had preached the grace of God, the new covenant. So now the Apostle Paul, as he's trying to wrap up correcting them, he says, let me use an allegory. You know how in the Old Testament, Abraham had two sons. One was born to a bondwoman and one was born to a free woman. He's getting ready to say, now Galatians, the old covenant and the new covenant are much the same. All right, he shows this in three different ways. So he compared and contrasted it in three different ways. The first one, He says the origin of these two men is very similar to the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. Let's look at it together. Look at what he says there in Galatians chapter 4, verse 23. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. Which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants. The one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is and is in bondage with her children. So first of all, he says, the one was born, his origin was born to a bondwoman. He was born in bondage. The Bible word here is gendereth. It simply means to be produced into bondage. He says Ishmael wasn't born the same way that Isaac was born. But Ishmael's origin was that of born into the family as a servant. He was born to a maid, and as such, he became a servant in his master's house. But Isaac, on the other hand, his origin was much different. Isaac's origin was he gendereth, is the Bible word, produced into freedom. Two totally different beginnings. The Apostle Paul says, these are the covenants. The one genders to bondage. The other genders to freedom. You know what every successive generation of Israelite knew without any doubt? That from the time they were born, they were too young to know it, but at 8 days old, they were taken. The males were taken to be circumcised and offered and presented to the priest. Why? Because they were born into a legal system that demanded that. They demanded that. There are people who today, spiritually speaking, are living in a system that demands they obey a law. It's what they're brought into. But not me. I was born again. And my second birth gendered me into freedom, spiritually speaking. Paul says, Galatians, it's so simple. So he uses their origins as a comparison to contrast the two. Look at the next comparison, though. Well, let's stick with that just for a minute. We find in John chapter 4, verse 19, I find this very, very interesting. It really gives us a good sense of what Paul was getting at when he's talking about the bondage and the worship and the system. Find John with me, if you would, please. Hold your place in Galatians. Just put your bookmark there and leave it there the rest of the night. We'll be coming and going. Find John chapter 4, verse 19. We find Jesus at the well, and this woman, you know, the Samaritan woman, is there and having this conversation with Jesus, and they're talking about the Samaritans, and they're talking about the law, they're talking about the Jews, but look at what it says. For time's sake, let's just jump into let's start in verse 17. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband, in that saidest thou truly. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Oh, here she goes. She just jumped right to where she knew the Jews would land. She said, our fathers have worshipped in this mountain for a very long time, but you being a Jew, you're stuck with Jerusalem. You say no one can worship anywhere except in Jerusalem. The law. She brings it up. I don't think for a moment that Jesus didn't see it coming. I think he may have even baited her into it. Look what he says, though. Let's look at verse 19. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. There's the old covenant. There's the law. Look what Jesus says. He says there's a new one coming. Look what he says. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me. The hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Jesus says, yeah, you're right. Jerusalem is where we're at. That's the old, but there's a new one coming. The day is coming when you're not going to have to go to Jerusalem or to this mountain. The day is coming where you're going to worship God in spirit and in truth. And he says, and it's even right now upon us. True worshipers are already doing it. It's the old versus the new. It's made pretty clear there. I find that very, very interesting. Look at verse 21. I like this. He says, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. This is the Isaac covenant. This is the Isaac part of that allegory. He gets on down, and the woman saith unto him, verse 25, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. And Jesus saith unto her, I that speaketh unto thee am he. Here, I want you to think about what just took place here. Jesus, listen, I wish the world could get this. Jesus just said, you're right. Jerusalem is where the law demands we go. But there's coming a day, something's going to change. Something's going to happen. And it won't be to Jerusalem or to this mountain. It'll be in my spirit I worship God. She says, I know what it's going to be. It'll be when the Messiah comes. Jesus says, he's here. This is the bringing in of a new. This is the ending of the old and the starting of the new. It's so clear. I love it. All right, so the first comparison is the origin. He says one was born into bondage, one was born, one gendereth to freedom. Let's talk about the freedom here real quick. I won't beat this point up or beat a dead horse, as they say. Go back to Galatians. Let's read it one more time. I'm intentionally reading it many times this evening because the more we read it, the more we'll remember it, and it's that important. Look with me, if you would, please, when we talk about the contrasting kinds of freedom. Verse 24, which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants, the one from the Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar. For this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. So first he uses their origins in this allegory to show the difference, and now he uses the freedom that is provided as the next comparison. He says that one that originated in Sinai, it answereth to Jerusalem. In other words, it's been moved to. It's the authority of it sits in Jerusalem. But the other one, it's in a Jerusalem too. But it's not a Jerusalem made with hands. It's the Jerusalem that's above. It's as though he's saying, would you just look at that's a so-called freedom of the Jerusalem of this earth. You got Sadducees and Pharisees who oppress, place you under a yoke. And you've got this freedom, this grace that God has extended to us. He said, you see the difference? It's the allegory. Find Acts chapter 15. We'll come back to Galatians again in a moment. Acts chapter 15. Peter spoke about this in one of those first church councils where they gathered together to kind of settle some disputes, and Judaism and Christianity were kind of colliding, and they're trying to figure out what was right and what was wrong. They were, those Jews at Jerusalem were trying to force all the new Christians to obey the law, and the new Christians were saying, what are you talking about? We don't need the law. And Peter stands up, and we say a lot of bad things about Peter, but to his credit, man, he nailed it. He did such a good job here in chapter 15. Look at what it says. Let's start reading together in verse 1 in chapter 15. Verse 5 says, but there arose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. All right, so there's the Pharisee side of things. These new converts have to keep the law. So they say, okay, let's get to the bottom of this. Let's call a meeting. Everybody meet in Jerusalem. And then we get down to chapter 15, verse 10. Peter began to stand up there in verse 7. He begins to talk. But look what he says in verse 10. Now, therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither your fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. There at the church council, all these wise church leaders get together, and they're saying they've got to be circumcised. They've got to keep the law of Moses. And Peter stands up and says, what are you talking about? You can't even keep the law. The law is just bondage. It's a yoke on our neck. He summarizes it by saying, we're convinced that they're saved by the same grace that we're saved by, absent the law. He said, it's an allegory. Why would you want to go back into that bondage? Take that yoke, put it back on your neck. Struggle underneath that yoke if you want. That law does not rule my life. The grace of God does. And then let's look at one more comparison, and this one will not take that long, I don't think. Go back to Galatians 4. The next thing he says about them is found here in verse 27. For it is written, hey, listen, everybody look right here. If you're new to the Bible, when you're reading your New Testament and you come across the words, it is written, the vast majority of the time, it's referring to something that was written in the Old Testament. It's referring to something that was prophetic when it was written, but speaking about something in the Bible days and 2,000 years ago was then current. All right, so just keep that in mind. So the Apostle Paul has reached all the way back to Genesis and said, let's create an allegory here. Let me illustrate this through these two men. And now he's jumped to another place in the Old Testament by saying, it is written. Look at what it says there in verse 27. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. Find with me, if you would please, the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, chapter 54. The book of Isaiah, chapter 54. I get excited when I think about what we're about to see. So listen, whether you're excited or not, at least smile and make me think that you are, okay? So Isaiah 53 is my favorite Old Testament passage. Isaiah 53, it is the Old Testament passage that talks about the crucifixion so very plainly. Isaiah 53, so that's going to be the topic of our Bible conference. It begins with, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He gets on down verses 4 through about 9, talks about his suffering and how it was our transgressions, it was our iniquity. He was afflicted, he was despised, we esteemed him not, as stricken, smitten of God, all of those things. But then you get into verse 9 of chapter 53. I know I said 54. I'm not crazy. Just stay with me. You get into verse 9 and 10 of chapter 53. Look at what it says in verse 10. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt see, or make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. Listen to this. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. You know what we just read? Isaiah 53 conclude with, through his death, there's going to be a whole bunch of people saved. Amen. through the suffering and the death of that Lamb of God, he's going to justify many. Don't make the mistake of looking at the chapter mark, though, and saying, well, this is over. It is not. Chapter 54, just take that division right out of there and just read right on down. You know what you're going to find? You're going to find a description of those many that are going to be saved. And he's not just talking about Israel. Look at it with me. He's going to justify many, end of chapter 53, verse 1 of chapter 54. This is where it was written. Remember Galatians? It is written, this is it. Look at what it says. Sing, O barren, thou that didst not bear. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, thou that didst not travail with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married wife, saith the Lord. Stop right there. Stop right there. Remember, the word allegory does not mean a perfect representation or likeness of. It's just simple, draw some thoughts to illustrate the point, right? Why would Paul say, let me quote a little something from Isaiah 54, that we're getting ready to read about someone who never had a spiritual spouse. They were barren and they were desolate. But God says, I'm going to intervene. And that those people who were barren had no husband, I'll be their husband. That group of people who had very few, very little to their name, I'm going to make them great. You know what he's talking about, don't you? Throughout the Old Testament, God said, Israel is my chosen people. Remember the Song of Solomon, my beloved is mine and I am his. He refers to Israel as the apple of his eye, his peculiar treasure. Where were the Gentiles? I'll tell you where they were. They were outcast. They were separated. They were desolate. They were without a husband, spiritually speaking. Paul says, something's happened. Something's happened. Isaiah 53 ends with, the suffering of Jesus Christ is going to justify many. Chapter 54 begins by him saying, I'm about to change the lives of a lot of people. It's no longer about the Jews and the Gentiles separate. It's about one together. The New Testament says it this way. They who were not a people, he made a people. It also says another place, there is now therefore in Christ Jesus, there is neither Jew nor Gentile, bond or free. We're all the same. Let's just read a few of these verses, and you're not excited about it. Brother Piper's pretending to be, but look at what it says in verse 2. He says, the children of the married wife, saith the Lord, verse 2, enlarge the place of thy tent. And let them stretch forth the curtains of thine habitations. Spare not, lengthen thy cords and strengthen thy stakes. You know what he's saying? The tent you've got's not going to be big enough. Hey, Jerusalem on the earth, you're not big enough. It's time to press out the walls of those tents, stretch the sides out, enlarge your dwelling place because the household just got a lot bigger. He says you better make it bigger. Look at verse 3. For thou shalt break forth on the right hand and on the left. Thy seed shall inherit the Gentiles and make the desolate cities to be inhabited. Fear not, for thou shalt not be ashamed, neither be thou confounded. For thou shalt not be put to shame, for thou shalt forget the shame of thy youth, and thou shalt not remember the reproach of thy widowhood anymore. For thy maker, capital M, thy maker is thine husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth shall he be called. We're not talking about the God of Israel. No. We're talking about the God of the whole earth. I'm so glad. And if I've got to be compared to one of those two sons from Genesis, I'm so glad I get to be compared to Isaac. Amen. The freedom in Christ Jesus. Those who were once desolate and without, God says, I'll be your maker. I'll be your redeemer. The whole chapter goes on. It just gets better and better, or gooder and gooder, as Brother Piper says. It's a wonderful, wonderful passage. All right, jump back to Galatians 4. Verse 28, now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. You know what promise he's talking about? He just said, as it is written. He just said, hey, just remember what the Old Testament said. And now he says, we are the children of promise. He points to that passage and says, it's us. It's us. And here's the amazing thing. Maybe you won't find this amazing. He says, brethren, we are the children of promise. Why is that significant? Who's he writing to? He's not writing to Jewish people. He's writing to Galatians, Gentiles, barbarians. And he says, brethren, we are the children of promise. Kind of sounds like that Isaiah chapter 54, verse 1 and 2, where God said, you better push out your tent a little bit. You don't have enough room for all these new people. Kind of sounds like the Apostle Paul says the Galatians are part of that new people. He says it's Jew and Gentile together, away from the law, just living in the grace and the liberty of Jesus Christ. Verse 29, but as then he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. He says, here's another comparison. He says, just as Ishmael persecuted and all that was going on, he's the same way now. It's just the reason I'm having to write this letter to you. They don't like that we have liberty and grace. And so they're persecuting us again. Look what he says next. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free. He tells these Galatians, throw out that law that you're living under. Get rid of it. We don't live that way anymore. It doesn't belong with the heirs, the joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Get rid of it. We are free. That's the message of Galatians. Seems pretty clear to me. Seems pretty clear. I'm so thankful that, first of all, that we have the law, that as Paul said, it acted as a schoolmaster. It showed us just how desperately we needed Jesus Christ. But I'm so thankful that after my new birth, God says, take off that yoke. I got a different yoke for you. Come unto me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly. I'll take that yoke. You can have the yoke of the law. Let's stand together, please. Father, thank you for your word. Lord, I've done my best tonight. Lord, I ask that please, Father, would you please make application deep into our hearts? Father, thank you for redeeming us from under the law. Thank you for the freedom we have in you. God, I pray that you would please help this passage not just be something we hear and then forget about, but Lord, I pray that you would help us as we try to mentally and spiritually digest all of this. God, would you help us learn from it and grow from it? God, would you help us as a result of what we've seen tonight? Would you help us love you more? Well, thank you in Jesus' name. Would you stand quietly with your heads bowed and your eyes closed? The altar's open this evening. I really have no idea how God may have spoken to your heart. Becca will play something softly. The altar is open. If you'd like to make use of it this evening, I invite you to. Sing page 467 together. I need thee every hour is the song. Let's sing this together. Page 467. Sing it together on that first verse. I see the prayer list on that table back there. Go grab one, and you can greet a couple more people. You got time for that. I see the kids in the foyer.